We did our movie homework, did we not, Rags?
We did do our movie homework. We did. We spent many hours with our homework. We watched some movies. We watched all the movies that people say that the Joker is just a ripoff of.
So I guess, do you want to go through them? We start with Taxi Driver, right? That was the
yeah,
first.
We started off with Taxi Driver. Wasn't all that good. It was kind of, I guess, like, eh.
I mean,
definitely one of the weaker ones we watched. It was certainly my least favorite of all the ones we watched. Didn't think it was all that great.
We should probably try and do it. I mean, we've got time. We could do a bit of detail if you want. So
yeah. Oh, I thought the pacing was really bad. I thought that there were a bunch of redundant scenes that simply weren't necessary or didn't serve much of a purpose. The writing was really clunky in a lot of parts. I think the protagonist's motivations were very, very lacking. He didn't even seem like a real person, in fact. I just really didn't care for it.
You're gonna
really
piss off so many people.
That's
all right. No, I know it's funny. That's all. Like, so my issues with Taxi Driver, I think it drags at parts, and that I really don't like Travis Bickle. And I know that that's not, it's like, well, who cares if you like him or not? It's like, oh, well, I mean,
well, we can't anything with him.
I guess, yeah. What I guess I'm referring to is strictly my engagement with the story, being that I struggle to empathize this situation because he's kind of an ass and a bit of an idiot as well. Like, you might be like, how does this not apply to Joker? It's like, oh, I guess we have to get into all of these little interesting tidbits. But I guess the film is about him trying to find motivation, as in to do. He doesn't know what he wants to do specifically. He wants to do something,
yeah.
And
yeah.
Bouncing between lots of different things, because the representation of what it's like to be a man with plenty of drive but nowhere to I guess direct it, and so like there's the approach with the nightlife, he describes the world as like scum. I guess he's referring to the pimps and the I guess there's some. I can't remember specifically
whores,
what he says, but
prostitutes.
Definitely
drug
seems
users.
Sexual and drug related. He's got a lot of issues with, and he wants Palantine to be the one to clean it up. Until, I guess, because this is the thing. There's lots of bits that I guess you have to watch some video essays to be clearer on, but that didn't seem to work out for us.
we watched some, and they just weren't really they weren't really well reasoned. But it's just the way that it describes why he does the thing that he does, and the way that it tries to elaborate on his motivations, is really poor. To the point where I was really wondering, in a way that I never had to do with Joker, I was wondering, why is he doing any of this? This seems to be, in fact, counter to what you would expect him to do, or what he seems like he would do. Just not, oof.
Yeah, I might say, I guess I take a softer stance to you, though. I actually think it's pretty well made. I just don't like it that much.
Well, it's well made in the sense that, like, are you talking about, like, shots and cinematography and execution of everything, or?
Even him, he is a character being this essentially a dare I say, creature that's just looking to find something to work with. He's bouncing between lots of different ideas. There's shaky ground in terms of understanding exactly what drives into each position, but, like, you know, looking at even discussions and reviews, people argue to this day about exactly why he does everything he does in that movie. Story. I find the idea that he was looking to commit to what could be considered a terrorist type plan with Palantine being redirected into attacking the pimps, being considered a hugely heroic act by a general audience when it wasn't necessarily exactly what would have happened had he been successful with Palantine. It's quite an interesting look at the situation of how different things can happen. And the implication being that he's like a ticking time bomb, and that this is only going to happen again because he's so lost in terms of what he's supposed to do with his life. I don't know. There's there's elements to it that I do find interesting, and the performances, the as put, lots of different directorial elements. I just my issue is such a difficulty in connecting with Travis Bickle. I just don't like him. I'm sorry, he's an ass.
Yeah, really, really tough to grasp his thought process and why he does the things he does. Not terrible. It's fine.
Also, I just spotted someone said you're not supposed to like him. How many video essays did we watch where they said
he was relatable?
He's relatable, understandable, and
understand him. Yeah,
us liking him is what like drives us. Like they would argue that liking him is a big part of why the film is well written, is that it makes a horrible person likable or something. And I was just like, oh,
I think at least two of the video essays that we watched said pretty much that you're supposed to really connect with him. He was so empathetic, and you could just level with him. It's like you could see yourself in his shoes. But if that was the case, they failed miserably. He didn't even seem like a human being. Very blank, distant. He had no real. He didn't seem like a human being.
And I think they were trying to translate that through a lot of his dialogue as well. He struggles to maintain a lot of conversations in a, like, especially with the
girlfriend in the coffee shop, with even with Palantine, he's blank for a lot of it until the end part.
Palantine seems to be sort of like giving him some looks like you're a weirdo, but sure, mm-hmm. that sort of thing.
Even when he's with the other cabbies, he's just there. Like he couldn't communicate very well. He didn't seem to have any interests, film, music, literature. There was just nothing that he just didn't. He just seemed empty, you know, almost like he was representative of something instead of a character, a person.
Yeah, out of all of the pro tags of all of the films we watched, he would be my least understandable and likable for me.
I didn't like him at all. There was nothing to like about him. There was nothing to grasp onto, nothing to relate to him with, really.
I was just going to say, because Mel, you've seen it as well. Do you have any thoughts about Taxi Driver?
Well, it's been a while now that I watched it. That's why I actually asked yesterday if I should rewatch it. Now I kind of feel bad that I didn't. I don't know. I don't think it's super good as well. It's like, I'm happy I watched it just for comparison, but it's nothing I would watch ever again, to be honest.
Yeah, I wouldn't.
Doesn't he have like this romantic thing going on with the girl and the, I don't know, whatever they do, the political stuff?
The Palatine office? Yeah, he does.
And that just fails miserably when he tries to get her into like a porn cinema.
Yeah.
It's like, okay.
Yeah. Which is
like, he's clearly not right mind.
Well, I think it's supposed to just be a representation of how his brain works, because at first he's like, she's an angel, no one can touch her, yay, woohoo, and then the second that it goes wrong with her, he's like, she's like all the rest.
Yeah, exactly.
So it's more like that one is more of an incel movie than The Joker, or are they about the same?
I would say, I guess Taxi Driver would be by default, because I don't even see how Joker is in any way.
It's quite clear how Joker is an incel movie. It's about a guy.
Oh, got it. I just find it funny that incel movie should be a genre. It's like, oh yeah, shit.
It's on Netflix.
And all this requires is male protagonist that we don't see have sex at any point. Like, oh, sweet.
Crazy and violent too.
Yes, Die Hard incel movie. He doesn't have sex in the movie. So.
Okay. Makes no psychological sense. Thriller, action thriller, incel thriller. There we go. That's what we want to see.
Incel thriller.
So, which was next? Was it Falling Down?
Falling Down was the one that we watched next, and I enjoyed it much more.
So, I don't even know what much did that one is. So,
but Falling Down is about. The main character has let's just say you. I'm going to describe this, and you'll be like, "Oh, I can see how this is considered related to Joker." So his character who's lost his job, his mother is, well, I was about to say overbearing, but I guess we don't get to know a lot about that. But lives with his mother.
His mother isn't overbearing. I would say that it's kind of the opposite in that aspect. Seems to be, she seemed afraid of him. She seemed, the mother seemed to be afraid of him. Like, she knew that he was prone to just snapping. She displayed to the detectives, to the police officers there, she displayed a real sense of fear that they were there. A lot of apprehension when they went into his room. She said, you know, don't tell him I let you in here and all that sort of stuff. So she clearly was had a level of fear about him. He certainly dominated that.
Someone in chat said, incel doesn't mean what you think it means, Waller. It's like involuntary celibate. I'm joking that all you need to do to be labeled an incel movie now is to have a male character who's not having sex at the time of seeing them in the movie. That seems to be all that, you know, but maybe there's more to it, because the fact that he imagines a girlfriend in Joker, that's enough to be like, see, incel. It's like, oh, okay.
Okay.
All right. Then.
All right.
And someone said I have a bad take on Joker, Taxi Driver. I'm just like, I'm not really bothered. I mean, nothing I said was untrue.
Neither of us. Yeah, neither of us. I mean, we could back up what we said. I watched it. I paid a lot of attention. Kind of feel like my time was wasted. Definitely.
We even watched three guides to the movie.
Yeah.
And which like, were a bit awkward because they got a couple of facts wrong several times, but hey.
Yeah, like we had to correct the video essays about them because they were just objectively making wrong statements about it. I just
imagine
didn't.
My shock.
Just didn't like it. But I know I could tell when I watched it. Yep, I can see why this is one of the sacred cows. But
oh well, that's the one thing that I recognize, much like the Godzilla fan base or certain other events of EFAP's history, to criticize Taxi Driver is you're not allowed to do that, but we don't really care. Like, we'll just happily move on. It's just like, oh, well, you know, that was that. Falling Down doesn't have that kind of defensive shield, as far as I know. It's especially because it's a Joel Schumacher film, which he's nowhere near as respected as Scorsese.
Down.
But, I prefer Falling Down. I actually very much understood everything pretty much definitively, and you can tell that there's a lot in that movie that's littered in to try and just represent everyday life for the, I guess, living the American dream, quote unquote. But I think it could work with American Beauty as another film of just being like, it's supposed to be working, but it's not, that sort of thing. And just all of the issues you'll discover over time in your lives that can be related to. The one that I just really like was the because they're all good, I think, to a degree, but the construction workers, just the immediate, like, you guys are wasting time, and you waste time because you need to waste time to get better contracts in future. If you take longer and need more money to do X, Y, and Z, then they'll give you more in future or maintain the same. And so all of this is just bullshit, and you're making everybody late, and you're cutting off good roads, and he just has an RPG or a bazooka or whatever, and he just there's a lot of, obviously he's reckless as hell, but the movie ramps up with every scenario, starting out quite calimly with traffic.
Starts off with traffic, very relatable, moves over towards overpriced items in a little supermarket, a little corner store, very very relatable stuff, and then it just goes up and up and up. He's certainly a lot more empathetic, certainly a lot more relatable than Travis Bickle is.
I think that a lot of people would consider the difference between those two as one's a film, the other one's more of an art film. Taxi Driver is more of a much higher tier of movie. It's much more respected. Falling Down is much more of a casual movie that has a lot of casual traits, I suppose. But I've been seeing a lot of strong feelings for Falling Down. A lot of people seem to like it, which is interesting.
I've actually seen the character before. I just googled it really quickly. I've definitely seen that character somewhere before.
I mean, it's a nice, it's tragic little story. I think what brings it all together is the when he looks at his tapes of himself with his family and how he can see himself being overtaken by temper. That's brought on, the implication is that it's brought on by all of the little things in life, everything just getting to him slowly, and that He uses the small amounts of money that he has to support his family to buy things and provide for them. And if they aren't enjoying it or using it, it's making him more and more frustrated because that's how everything's supposed to work, that sort of thing. And so you could just, understand his frustration. And you get a B-plot of understanding the cop that takes him down the whole time as well.
Yeah, they mesh really well together. I thought that the cop and the protagonist... I thought both their stories kind of running parallel was done really well and both well acted, and you're glad that things kind of turn out the way that they do and everything is wrapped up fairly neatly. But
the dude in the what was the store called? The type of store? The Nazi dude.
Oh,
remember?
Like an army surplus store?
That was the one, yeah. He was a bit weird.
Yeah, kind of weird, kind of a weirdo guy.
But yeah, it all gets sorted out. So there was that one, then King of Comedy was after that, right?
After that, we watched King of Comedy, which I liked quite a bit. Really like King of Comedy.
I guess to be simplified, King of Comedy is about an aspiring comedian who idolizes a talk show host. Mm-hmm. And he's trying to find any way he can to break out and, live the dream of being a successful comedian. And the film sort of, he tries a lot in the film, leading ultimately up to kidnapping said host.
And the movie starts off with him really willing to start off the bottom, sort of. He starts off the bottom. He wants to get into show business with, what's his name, Jerry
Lewis, is it?
Yeah, Jerry Lewis. Yeah.
Well, in real life, in the film, it's Jerry Langford, I think.
Yeah, Jerry Langford. That's it. And then he tries to get in with him. He gets obsessive, and you get to see Jerry Langford's his lament about being famous. He's always being troubled and assaulted, and all that good stuff. But the thing is, he doesn't. The main character does get what he wants in the end. His kidnapping play works. After that, he writes a book, gets $1 million. It's kind of the opposite of what a dark version or the inverse version of your traditional American dream, where you work hard and you work diligently and then you achieve your dreams. He just kind of skipped to the top and committed a crime, blatantly committed a crime, and then got rewarded with everything he wanted and more.
I find
interesting movie.
One of the most subversive parts of that movie is the fact that his set isn't too bad. Like the jokes he actually delivers once he gets on there, it's like, oh,
it's pretty good.
Yeah, yeah. You expect it to be terrible and horrible and cringy and awful, but the jokes were actually pretty good.
Yeah, he kills it on stage. Everyone laughs. Everyone loves him. And I thought that was going to turn out to be one of those elaborate fantasies he has. But as opposed to Arthur Fleck, he actually is in control of his fantasies. He knows when he's doing them. So it turned out to be actually real, which was interesting. I did not see that one coming. That one actually successfully severed my expectations.
I didn't expect it either. It caught me off guard. I was like, oh, wow. And then when we watched it again, when we watched it today, that was the second time I'd seen it. So all of that stuff was recontextualized. And we picked up a lot of, how the dialogue was very interesting now that we knew that, it was all in his head and stuff like that. And it owes itself to a second viewing that I think is really well written.
Oh, I recommend it. Because they build up the entire movie that he's going to be this guy who thinks he's a big shot. The very first thing we see him say, or one of the first things we see him say, is that I know I'm dynamite. I know I'm really good. And we have the same vision of him as probably the comedian character, the Jerry character, and that, oh yeah, he just thinks he's good. He's not really that good. He's an amateur. He's just starting out. He needs to start at the bottom, work at the comedy clubs, and then he turns in his his tape of his set, and they said, yeah, you got some good things in there, but it needs polishing. So obviously, by the very end, by the time he gets on stage, it's you're kind of set and ready to hear his cringy jokes, but he kills it. He's really good, and he succeeds.
It's worth mentioning though that with that film and Taxi Driver and Joker, there's still discussion to this day, despite what the creators say about each film, that whether or not the endings are all real or not. Now, Taxi Driver, I believe the producer, Robert De Niro, and Scorsese have all said it's real, but people still say that it's a fantasy at the end because he actually died. or that he's actually in jail and that he sees himself as the hero and that's why he's imagining it. For Joker, it's take any selection of the movie and it could be real, could be not. The whole thing could be real, could be not. Like, a lot of people are running with that. And then with King of Comedy, it's that he never... I guess it's like he may never have left jail and that he was never successful and that there are visual cues to imply that he may very well still be in jail or that it is real. It's interesting to talk about in terms of what the references may or may not show, but I don't find it useful to just be like, was it all a dream? I don't know. Moving on. Yeah. You're like, oh, okay.
I personally dislike that whole it was all a dream thing. I prefer it to be real if I can if it can be argued that the whole thing was real. But within the case of Putton, I think that's his name. He has, I keep forgetting his name, but the main character Putton, we get to see him. He has a very vivid imagination. He has very vivid fantasies, and we get to see him kind of playing one out as if he and the comedian character, the Jerry character, were friends and colleagues. And he gets so into it that he kind of disregards real life. So it could be argued on that note that the very end, all of that, all of his success, his $1 million book deal, him having his own comedy set and people introducing him and people loving him in his red suit, that could be yet another elaborate fantasy that is actually foreshadowed in the beginning of the movie. So it could be argued that it's real. It could be argued that it's not real. It's both could be plausible.
And I would say that of the three, the most ambiguous ending, like if you were going to say of all the three, if the three endings were a dream or a hallucination or whatever, I think King of Comedy is the one you could most justify with it.
Yeah.
Yeah. For Taxi Driver, I don't think you really could much at all. For Joker, I don't think you could either, especially when it pulls away from his perspective to Thomas and Thomas's wife, the Wayne's getting killed.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think he would. He certainly wouldn't imagine her getting killed. He wouldn't want that. We see him sparing people who are nice to him. That's kind of his whole deal. He has a system. He has a structure. But with King of Comedy, you're like, maybe this is all.
It could happen. I think that if someone managed to barter their way onto a thing with like kidnapping or blackmail their way on whatever, that if they had a good enough set, that they'd have enough fans to pull them back into the spotlight.
Pumpkin.
Possible. And yeah, Rupert Pupkin is his name. And yeah,
Pupkin is his name. Rupert Pupkin. That's it.
They pronounce it wrong throughout the film. It's a good running
joke. Mr. Pumpkin is here.
Yeah.
Pumpkin. Yeah.
And Pipkin and stuff like that.
One thing I really liked about his character, Rupert Pumpkin's character, was that he never changed his demeanor really, but he went from a guy you saw as just a normal, enthusiastic guy who's really energetic, really passionate about his chosen path of comedy, being a comedian like Jerry. And without him changing his demeanor, he goes from a guy you might see as just endearingly enthusiastic, endearingly passionate, to someone who's insane by the time he does the kidnapping portion of it.
He's the part that really like sells that Pupkin has problems to me is when, because I think one of the first delusions we see, there's like credence to imagine that it might actually be happening, but it's a bit confusing. But then once you discover, it's like, oh, none of these are happening. Like, they're very vivid, and
I think that him getting in the car with him, that is, I understand, supposed to be real.
Yeah, yeah.
But that's the interaction that he uses with his obsessive mind to base everything else on. He hangs on to it, and it essentially is the spark that starts everything becoming just worse and worse.
And you get the one where he's like talking to him about how you should come to his house and stuff, and then he actually turns up there with a girl who's not in on the delusion. So she's like, wait, what?
It's cool. You're friends with this really famous person, and all of a sudden, no, he's not really. They're calling the cops.
And then he's like, you're just like all the rest. You're a terrible person. Immediately turns on him instead of him being like a hero. And then that's when it gets cranked up to kidnapping, which
which he carries out with, like Literature Devil said, his demeanor doesn't really change for the whole thing. He has this very cool, collected kind of aloofness.
Mm-hmm.
It's almost just like, well, I guess the next step is kidnapping. And
he is sure.
It's very logical kind of.
He's sure that he's good, so he just needs his break. That's all this is. He's just certain that as long as he gets people to listen to his jokes, give him a chance, that he'll be successful. And it turns out he was.
I think the fact that his routine that's shown at the end being so good, it kind of vindicates him in a way where you feel like, okay, Rupert he actually is good, and maybe that's part of it that really frustrates him. Like he of all these guys, he really does have an understanding of good comedy, and that's one of the reasons why he feels so frustrated, why he feels like he needs to go to these extreme lengths, because he knows in his head that my stuff really is good. He's not just being denied for the lack of talent.
But he is simultaneously a bit of a crazy person, as in from what we see. He's like, he's a bit crazy as well.
Yeah, that's what mixes it.
Yeah, no, it's why I do like that movie quite a bit. Very interesting idea to, like, the whole film focused around just a character who wants to be a successful TV host. Like, huh. And I think when I'd first seen it, I didn't expect him to freaking kidnap him. I was like, whoa.
Because he seems kind of meek, you know? He doesn't seem, he doesn't seem too confrontational, at least not to that degree. But he never comes across as malicious. If anything, comes across as desperate. And he doesn't want to hurt anybody. He just really feels like this is the last option for him to see his dream happen.
And then You Were Never Really There. That was the other one.
That was the other one, yeah.
I'd say that's probably the most art film out of the four, actually. If we're going to...
Yeah,
that genre is ill-defined as it is.
Yeah.
So that's a movie about an ex-veteran who takes what you could call like wet work jobs to try and rescue slash... It's complicated because we don't know exactly, but we see him... The job that we see in the film is he's trying to rescue a little girl from being, like, essentially sex trafficked, I think. And, you know, throughout the film you discover more and more of his past that brought him to where he is, more about himself, and there's a bit of a subversion in terms of there's, like, a final fight, but it doesn't end the way you'd expect, because the girl in question... I don't know how much I should say, because I don't know how many people have seen it, but... the reason why it's relevant is it's a film with Joaquin Phoenix with mental illness, and he lives with his mother. Like, that is the connective issue to Joker, I imagine. But again, I don't know if we've specified this yet, but these films are all extremely different from Joker.
Yeah, which would you say is the closest to Joker?
It's not. This is the thing. I suppose you can pull pieces out of all of them.
Yeah, there's pieces in all of them. I would say that King of Comedy is the closest to Joker, but that's not saying a lot because it's still very, very different.
There are several parallels between King of Comedy and the story of Arthur Fleck and the Joker. I mean, the Rupert Pupkin lives. I mean, he lives with his mom. It's very clear. He has these elaborate fantasies. He wants to...
Actually, is it clear that he really lives with his mom?
All we ever hear is her voice. We don't ever actually
see her. Yeah, we hear her voice. He might... And, you know, there is that... there is that fact that he made that joke during his set that, you know, he's been dead for 9 years. She might be dead, and she might just be an illusion. But his mother is a factor in there. She's just somewhere in his mind somewhere. So there's the mother factor that she's still with him. And then there's a fact that he wants to, he has an obsession over a talk show host, stand-up comedian sort of character. But their motivations are different. Their goals are different. But I can see a lot of parallels between the two characters and their two characters' journeys.
Yeah, I think there's the closest, it's closest there, yeah.
But, man, are they different, though.
Very good.
First of all, just go as far as being like, Joker's clearly on a a more murderous path, let's put it that way, because the conclusion for both characters is dramatically different. The world they're living in is dramatically different. The motivation is both similar and different, as in both aspiring comedians, but that is, and that stays Rupert's motivation and conclusion with the film, but Joker's evolves.
So I think Rupert Pumpkin, his entire goal is to become famous so that you can, all the dreams you see him have can come true. He has a very very vivid imagination. We can see vividly all the things he wants to happen. He wants to become famous. He wants all the people who disliked him or wronged him to just come back and apologize, to acknowledge to him that they were wrong for doubting him, to marry the woman of his dreams, all that good stuff. Joker, Arthur Fleck, on the other hand, he's not really looking for fame specifically. He is looking for meaning in his life, some sort of identity. And that plays into the main themes of the Joker movie.
Yeah, and I get, well, I was going to say, I didn't mean to skip over You Were Never Really There, but that is, I don't know, it feels like out of the four that we've got over, that's probably the one that people haven't seen the most, and so I just figure that it's probably better not to say.
For me, it's the hardest to put a beat on.
It's rather non-linear, and the interesting thing that I found was that it was almost recommended, right, by several people, but if you look at the reviews for it, that film has been quite, beaten, let's say. Like, people
don't like it.
People are very unhappy.
Why they don't like it?
I
didn't dislike it, though.
No, I didn't dislike it. I was actually quite hooked for a while.
I was too, yeah.
And Joaquin does fantastically in it, portraying this, because a lot of the film is very focused on abuse and what it does to a person. It's very clear in the protagonist and the girl in question. The girl attempted to be saved. Again, I'm just trying to avoid going any further than that, but check it out, people. It's gonna pop up from what I know, because these are the films that are all referenced by Ralph. I'd be interested. We can talk more about them as we get there. Also, it's called You Were Never Really Here. I think I may have said they were,
I don't
they
even
all...
remember what the name of it was.
I guess that's it for the movies that we had to watch for homework, right? Because then we watched the other things we've been watching are more just Oscar-nominated films that we need to catch up on in terms of what's good that came out. I don't know if we want to talk about that or not. We could probably save it for another time, but...
Yeah, we could save it for another time, or we could just briefly... Just a brief, we saw this and we thought this. Maybe just give people little updates. Let me actually go through our downloads. Let's see all the stuff that we've been watching. It's taking forever. My download. I need to clear out my downloads folder.
Oh well, from memory. I mean, we can stay vague, but
We saw Jojo Rabbit, and it was really good.
Give it a big thumbs up.
Big thumbs up for Jojo Rabbit.
Fine, I watched that.
We saw
1917.
Did you see that Literature Devil?
Which one was
first
it?
First off, Literature Devil. Okay, your name is six syllables, so we're gonna have to do something about that. What do you normally go by?
If we were shortened it down to Lit Dev.
Lit Dev?
Mm-hmm.
Can we call you Devil?
Fucking Lit.
That'll work. Devil, can we call you Satan? the Prince of Darkness? The Lord of Lies?
No, we found out from Infinitisms the Devil never welches on a deal or whatever.
Okay, then he can't. Then let's make a deal, Satan. You tell him, I'll ask you a question and you answer it. So... Did you see Jojo Rabbit, and did you like it?
I have not seen Jojo Rabbit, no.
All right. We saw The Lighthouse.
Yes.
And I liked it.
I like it, too.
I liked it.
It's not a conventional movie in any means.
Oh, no. It's kind of, it's like, it's artsy, but in like a good way. Like, legitimately, actually a good way.
I was pretty hooked.
Really.
And holy shit, yeah. Willem Dafoe. Holy shit, man.
The fact that he was not nominated for some award is a crime.
I don't understand how that happened.
I don't get it either.
You watch him in that film, and he is that character. Willem Dafoe's God. He's just this the old man.
Yeah, he did very well. He did very well.
Did you see The Lighthouse, Satan?
No, I haven't seen that one either.
right. Well, maybe you saw the other movie that we watched. This is actually in reverse order I'm going, because I'm going from left to right on my downloads folders.
Wow.
We saw Parasite.
Yes.
Parasite was good.
Are you and I the only ones who've seen that here? I think so.
I don't even know what the fuck that is.
Okay, well, so yes. Parasite was very good.
Yes.
The just every filmmaking element was popping. And a really, really cool story that I felt I hadn't really seen before. And it's it was only after the when the remain vague, when the brother begins to bring the sister in that I was like, wait a minute. What's happening here?
I think the end was a bit tismy.
There's some tisms there, sure.
But man, still absolutely worth watching. Go watch Parasite. Go watch The Lighthouse. Go watch Jojo Rabbit.
1917.
And go watch 1917.
Oh, yeah. I watched that yesterday in the cinema. It was very good.
Go watch 1917 again and again. Good shit.
It was very, very good.
We can probably elaborate on them as time goes on, but obviously we've already... Yeah. We're coming up to an hour-long intro here, so
just a quickie little, you know, just looking at the films, talking about the movies, brushing up on our. I don't know if we're officially gonna do the Fappies, but we're getting there.
The only reason why I'm against it is because of how we haven't seen, like, how would it work? How do we nominate? How do we vote? How does? And I know it's all for fun, so who cares? But I'm like, I don't know.
What we can do is we can have personal Fappies together.
And oh, no. Not again.
What we can do...
I just like the idea that we nominate and the chat get to vote on which wins.
I would legitimately be curious to see if we did line them all up, what the chat would go for. And then we could measure that against... Like what the professional award giver people are at the Oscars, or the Ooskers, if you're in Canada.
Judging from chat, I think Parasite would win. People are very positive about that one.
I have my list of movies for next week when I'm on the train again. For
the thing is that with Parasite, I wouldn't agree it's the best, but I can certainly see why people think that, because I really liked watching Parasite. Because I don't know if mine is Joker or 1917.
I love both of those. They would be my top two for the year.
Yeah, those would be top two. I would like to watch 1917 again, because Joker's fresh, doubly fresh, because I watched it today.